So the title of this one is called Manifesting Equitable Futures, Building an Anti-Racist Technoculture. And so, as I mentioned before, it'll be a presentation, and this presentation is going to cover several different topics, including an intro of me and Afrotectopia, who's hosting this event, or this hosting this Welcome Wednesday via Eyebeam, the vision of Afrotectopia and the history of how it came about. Then we're moving into understanding race in America, studying its design, challenges that have occurred in creating an equitable technology, solutions that people have proposed, ways that technology has pronounced the racial disparities and discriminations that have already existed, things that we need to consider as we build our own manifesto. So we'll be building the manifesto together collectively today, things we need to consider, and finally building. So, so, hi again, my name is Ari Melenciano. I'm an artist, a technologist, creative technologist, researcher, a futurist, amongst other things. But mostly just enjoy and very passionate about learning how various forms of design impact people and their experiences. And so, I'm also the founder and producer of Afrotectopia, and Afrotectopia was created during my second year last year at NYU's Interactive Telecommunications Graduate Program. And the festival stemmed really out of a personal experience of being one of very few Black people in the program, of being the only Black person in my class, raising my hand, sharing concerns about how the technologies we're building and learning about can really harmfully affect Black people and marginalized communities, making a lot of activist-oriented work and not finding community people around me that are maybe similar work that I can maybe learn from or share with or support their work. So really thinking about how can we create a space where it's not enough one of the very few Black people when thinking about technology, and technology is dismissing topics, dismissing things like race, culture and identity, but more centering it, so I can have an environment that really centers race when considering technology, and also the community people that are working in this field that can support each other and build together. So Afrotectopia was a great event in that we were able to really invest in financially, investing $10,000 into Black people of color creators and businesses, as well as creating a $5,000 scholarship for an incoming Black IT student, and all of this is being done when we initially started with a $0 budget, so it's a lot of fundraising. And so the idea has really been to make Afrotectopia a social institution that's really fostering interdisciplinary innovation when thinking about Black empowerment. So at the festival, it was people coming from so many different backgrounds, urban design, or technology, or education, or health, really thinking about how can we use the arts, and especially technology, to uplift the Black community. And so I'm excited to share with you the vision. It's been a long time coming, but just thinking about what is Afrotectopia after the first round, thinking about the feedback that people have offered in attending, and even those that weren't able to attend. What could Afrotectopia offer society in general, but especially the Black community? And a lot of it is really with the feedback received from the first festival, people that are coming to Afrotectopia want to build things together. We want to not sit around and listen to people talk, but more join initiatives and think really intentionally about what we can do with what we have to build. And so it's doing that, creating more spaces to foster that kind of thinking and create opportunities for people to work together and build one another. And so it really stems from this idea that we have to stop purely being reactionary, though we aren't currently, but really less reactionary and more visionary, of not so much only protesting in the streets or thinking about how we combat what's going on, whatever racial injustice is happening at the moment, but really designing the future that we want to live in, and giving that future to people that are in the streets fighting for them to use as they're combating and fighting too. So a form of what we know today of that is building our own manifesto. So this manifesto is really a challenge for ourselves to think about what ways can we think about how race is operating in America, how racial discrimination is being replicated in technologies, and ways that we can get ahead of that and stop that from happening in the future. And building the future, something that's really important to know is always that you have to understand how the past has operated. In what ways was society designed? Who was it designed for? Who was it designed to most benefit for? Who was it designed for? And it's also important that whoever makes the rules of the game has a better chance of winning it. So historically white men have created the society that benefits them the most. When we get ahead of it, we design systems that are benefiting a collective mind of people, empowering all people, all of us collectively. So that was much of my research. What I'll talk about is much of my research that I've had while at ITP, the research there, which I've done for the past year, thinking about technology imaginatively, about creative ways that you can use it for artistic expression, but also how it may impact society negatively, especially Black and Latino and marginalized communities. And the main points of concern that I had when thinking about that side of technology is how has racial inequity been historically designed? In what ways is racial inequity cycling into today's technology? And in what ways can we imagine eradicating racial inequity for the future? So this is really understanding race in America from the 17th to 20th century and thinking about it through a lens of social. And I'm talking fast because we don't have much time and I want to listen to the workshop and to building together. But this was done mostly through a lens of sociology, public policy, urban design, economy, surveillance, technology, and other things. And a helpful way of kind of navigating a lot of the research that I've been doing in the past year and a little beyond is kind of creating this oppression machine, like mapping that out. What does that look like? Because historically, a lot of different facets of knowledge and ranges of knowledge have been working together in ways that we think of siloed and completely independent. So when it comes to economy and urban design or the military or government or education, all these things have some branches that are connecting them amongst each other and thinking of in what ways happening. So this is a general map, and then I'm going to dive in further as far as how a lot of them have worked together. So in designing America, this is a lot of focus on urban design and how after the World War and World War II and the GI Bill was created, and that was allowed, was created really a settlement of the American economy, and how that was mostly for white families to be able to get low interest mortgage rates or discounts basically on mortgage rates and completely exclude the Black families. And how that whole act of the government or the FHA, but the government supported that, the Federal Housing Association, building allowing them to do that created the racial disparity that we have today. And how those, the racial disparity and the segregation of housing has affected things like education or access to healthcare or different facets. So I'm going to briefly go over these kind of main areas and then dive into how technology is working. Thinking about the internet and how the internet was basically a tool by the military for sort of like ethnographic surveillance of Southeast Asia during the Vietnam War, and how they were using these kind of intelligences and thinking and technologies to surveil the communities there that they were opposing and trying to beat the war, and how the intelligences that they gained from that of surveilling the Southeast Asians and seeing what affects them and how they can use that to manipulate them. So things like killing their leaders or actually designing poverty in their communities creates, really disrupts their communities and harms them in very negative ways. And using that intelligence and taking it into the US during the 70s and 60s and thinking and into specifically inner city communities, especially Black communities, because at the time the biggest threats to the state were Black and anti-war left people, and thinking of how can we use the intelligence that we gained from poverty in Southeast Asia and create that into Black communities today. So designing poverty through counterinsurgency. Studying the war on drugs, which was inevitably a war on poverty and a war on crime, essentially a war on Blackness, and how thinking of when President Nixon was the president and how he was using drugs as a way to get into Black communities and understand what they were thinking, because this was around Black power movement, and what things that they were communicating amongst each other and how that they could find ways to get excuses into those spaces and surveil them in a deeper way. And so we see here a quote from Nixon's former domestic policy advisor saying that we could disrupt these communities, we could arrest their leaders, raid their homes, break up their meetings, and vilify them night after night on the news, and while knowing that they were lying about they had a huge amount of drug activity in their communities, when it's noted that drug activity is very similar across the different racial communities. So this just reinforces and shows the transparency in how the government was using this idea of war on drugs to really surveil the Black community. And then this really creates kind of the branding that's been created around Blackness and the idea that they're criminal or that they're subject to a lot of drug activity or unworthy of things like welfare. And the idea that welfare was actually a categorical system racism, where you have observing and undeserving, and we can do things like say that black people are more common or more likely to do drugs. You're thinking that they are probably more likely to spend whatever welfare money that the government is giving them onto the drug money. So really, these different attacks onto the black image really defined what blackness was in South America and even locally. So then I was thinking, in what ways has racial inequity, thinking on these topics that I've gone over very quickly, has cycled into understanding race in America today in the 21st century? And what's happening a lot is that there's this sort of false dichotomy between technology and ethics and humanity. So technologists, a lot of times technologists, they just need to focus on innovation and creating something really cool and fun that'll get a lot of money and not really paying attention to how it might impact the future, impact societies in the future. We can think quickly to Facebook and now social media platforms like that were created not thinking about how they really replicate a lot of racial discriminations that were happening. And so this is a really important kind of change that we need to conquer, thinking about how can technologists also be in the same circle of with ethics, people that are focused on ethics and people that are familiar with communities. And so some ideas that I've had around this are include things like how the FDA has created operates with the food and drug industry, with the food and drug distribution and manufacturing, of them being the ones that are regulating things that are entering our bodies and entering our communities without food and drug companies doing so. So what if there's a sort of technology kind of version of that, where if technologists don't want to focus on ethics and humanities, they still can't release things that they're producing in society unless it's regulated and passed by a group that are very well aware of ethics and how these things might affect different things. So challenges, general challenges that come up when you think about how can we use technology in very equitable ways, including, for one, the access to technology education. Who gets to learn how to do computer science and who doesn't? And generally, when you're looking at schools that are of higher percentage of black and Latino population, they don't have advanced curriculum, including computer science or higher levels of math. So that already creates a digital divide as far as who's able to enter the conversation and learn at a younger age. So thinking of how can we use technology to democratize education, even though there's a lack of it, a lot of these solutions may be very relative to the economic standard of America, and obviously wouldn't apply to a lot of other places in the world, but using things like computer vision or augmented reality, we kind of reimagine how education works and blending different mediums together or different subjects together, like math and music together. We're using technology to really reimagine it and no longer require access to things like laptops. A lot of students today in maybe lower middle income areas don't have a laptop or computer at home, but they have a cell phone. So how can we use the fact that they have a cell phone to still allow them to enter the computer science field? Today you're able to code on cell phones, thinking very intentionally about that. Other really great programs that are occurring are things like I Can See What They Can, or Black Girls Code, but I also want to make a plug for Afrotectopia Summer Camp that will be happening in a few weeks, where we're really thinking about how can we combine art, design, technology, activism, black culture together, and create a curriculum that really is culturally relevant and speaks to the students that we're serving. Oftentimes, computer science education really centers whiteness and excludes a lot of people by just doing that. Another thing is building internet in developing countries through cyber warfare, and considering how, even with the Vietnam War, and how a lot of the work that was being done through that was very technology-based. It's been known that the next war is anticipated to be completely cyber warfare, where one country is able to turn off the water supply or electricity in another country purely through internet infrastructure. And so thinking about how large tech companies have the capability and are actually doing it today of building internet infrastructures in developing countries is a really scary thought when thinking of how now they have this huge leverage for how that community and country can operate going forward. A very big and popular issue has been mass incarceration, and also thinking about how that really kind of expounds the idea of capitalism and how it moves really how surveillance and mass incarceration, it allows for not only people that are incarcerated inside a penitentiary or a jail or those kind of systems in-house within walls, but how surveillance is now being applied to everyone in our community. in some way be incarcerated, not through, not within walls, but be surveilled in a way where they could likely be associated with a certain crime because they're Facebook friends with someone, or they're walking down the street in New York City and New York City police cameras are capturing the reason which they recognize. So these are general concerns, and they pose us problems when thinking about how mass incarceration and thinking about the future of work and post-work society. So with automation, a lot of concern is that it's going to wipe out a lot of jobs and that people won't be able to keep up. People that aren't very tech savvy won't be able to keep up. So what's going to happen with people that have been inside of the incarceration system, the lumping class of people that are not being as many skills as people that are outside of it, assumingly, what will happen to them when we get to post-work society? What will happen to the peer-to-peer based app workers that don't really have a union because there's no connection between them and their other work, their other co-worker, technically, but they're all being pipelined, I guess, through the owner of the app. And this has been a concern for decades, with automation wiping out the proletariat class. The Black Panther Party was thinking about this, and under the Marxist theory, we're thinking about Marxist automation theories, because a lot of the Black Panther Party were proletariats themselves, and so they were thinking about how could they, and another the working class, where they're traditionally known as people that are, they're of lower economic means, and they are hard to organize, because there's not much that are organizing together as far as the workforce. But with the Black Panther Party, they were really bringing themselves together and educating themselves to think about how can we combat this back then. So it's of utmost importance to think about it, especially now. And so potential solutions have been vast, but a few that I do want to know are things like the robot tax, which is used to incentivize companies from replacing human work with robots and machines, and instead taxing them maybe at the same rate as what income tax for the person that would have had that job would be, and then use that as a sort of social safety net for people that would become displaced. The fact that automation would potentially wipe them out. Bail Lock is a really innovative and cool collective of technologists and other professions that are thinking about how can we use maybe its computing power or cryptocurrency to help combat separation of families through ICE or help fund and bail bonds for people who need it. And another interesting read that I've been diving into is the architecture of techno-democracy, which thinks about how technology can really make democracy maybe more democratic and allow for more voices to be heard as opposed to the 1% that are elected to represent all of us, but allow for all of us to communicate what our ideas and concerns are. So as we create this manifesto that's embedding racism, that's already permeated the current technoculture, it's important to realize that it doesn't matter that it's not the technology that matters itself, but it's the community and the culture that it's creating out of. And currently our culture is extremely white, heteronormative, and that's who's prospering the most when it comes to all the technology that's being developed today. So it's a huge challenge to redesign what society, how society operates today, but it is creating a standard and challenging. So as we build our manifesto, these are different things that are important to keep in mind as far as how technology has continued cycles of poverty, racism, and in considering urban design and resources. So before I was mentioning how with the GI Bill, that allowed for white families to get homes and Black families were excluded. When the GI Bill occurred, when that was happening, Black families were then being pushed out to the outskirts of the neighborhood, being closer to commercial real estate or warehouses. And in today, where we're having same-day delivery service with Amazon, these are things that are being replicated where the Black communities inside of a city could be completely, or actually when Amazon same-day delivery service was released, were excluded from the service. So oddly enough, in Boston, where Roxbury is in the center of the Boston metropolitan area, it was completely excluded from the Amazon day service while all the surrounding neighborhoods were included. And when Amazon was asked about this, they were saying it was completely dance intentional. They didn't know that this was happening. They were just trying to give it to the most. They were just trying to make it the most optimal as possible for themselves as far as profit and gain. This happens because things like the GI Bill and not having someone at the table that understands how community segregation has happened historically, and allowing for things like this to happen. It also happened in Washington, D.C., where wherever there were Black communities congregated the most together, same-day service generally did not serve that community because they were generally near warehouses or kind of out in further areas where it would be more expensive for Amazon to serve them. Urban design has also played a role in economy and wealth acquisition and access to education. The ways that we see that having happened most recently are things like predatory lending, where before the stock market crashed and banks were going into predominantly Black neighborhoods and offering them subprime mortgages where they would be able to buy a home for their family at a much cheaper rate than they would have expected, but then they had a huge interest rate that ballooned by the time that they were maybe a few years into paying. And this is a big concern because not the racial wealth disparity gap was already huge at the time, but this further widened the disparity gap because families invested in these homes that they were no longer able to pay for a few years in and lost a lot of money. And ways that the technology is replicating these kind of discriminatory practices when it comes to real estate is things like Facebook. So one of Facebook's biggest revenue streams is their ad services. So people can say that I'm selling a home or I'm selling a car, and pick who they want to be able to see the ad. And they can pick the age, they can pick a zip code, and when you're able to pick a zip code, people are literally able to digitally redline certain areas. And these redline areas obviously include people of African or Latinos descent. So when you're able to do this and you're selling a home, and you say you don't want people of whatever zip code with predominantly Black community in it, that's discriminatory to those people, and those people can't see that house being sold. There's also urban design and how it's branched into over-policing and policing, because when you segregate areas and you put all Black people in one area and then you completely divest all resources and access to things that they need, there are higher crime rates happening because it's really hard to build wealth and get everything they need to have a family that has everything they need. So, we also see digital communication and surveillance and targeting happening with that. And ways that we can see this happening is with things like Eyebeam, working with NYPD and creating surveillance footage, or using NYPD public surveillance footage, feeding into data sets that allow anyone that's using the technology to determine a race or ethnicity of someone based on. So those are really fast glimpses of what's going on, and this alone shows a whole lot created by AI now, a really amazing institution that talks about and thinks about ethics in relation to technology, and them creating a map alone of things like self-driving cars and Tesla, and how the first person that was killed by a self-driving car incident happened with Facebook, or Project Maven, or other really huge issues that are occurring based on AI and technology and not considering how it's impacting society in any good ways. So as we build this, it's really important to think about whose interest is being served. A lot of these technologies we saw weren't meant to be harmful for people, but they are. None of the arguments are not considering how they impact people. And a really interesting example includes facial recognition. Joy, who I always mess up her last name, Lee and Timnit Ibru, who are with the Operative Justice League and Blacks in AI, have done a really spectacular job of thinking about how facial recognition can exclude or be highly problematic when it comes to darker skin faces. And so they use three pretty well-known commercial technologies that said that they were capable of being able to identify someone's gender by really looking at their face. But they were very wrong when considering when they were shown faces of darker skinned women and highly accurate when showed the faces of lighter skinned men. So what Joy and Timnit were able to do was create a data set that was a lot more balanced and which was great, but we also need to think about who's using that technology. When it comes to police, are they using that to recognize black faces? Now, are they better able to recognize black faces because we've improved on the data set that allows them to do that more? And also thinking about how we're helping create a tool that's being able to determine someone's gender by their outwardly appearance. And that excludes people that are of the trans community or gender non-conforming, and how their outwardly appearance might not match the gender that they identify. So thinking about all these different things, it's time for us to go and work together and thinking about what would a manifesto look like that includes people of many different backgrounds, whether it's race, socioeconomic living conditions, or where they are as far as in the world, and how can this manifesto get ahead of technology companies and create something that is required by all tech companies that require it when it goes to the bank. So I'm happy to answer any questions, and this is also really meant to be a discussion of all of us, communicate with one another and share our thoughts. With this, while I wait for it, in case anyone has any questions, you all have a pamphlet. So this pamphlet is giving instructions as far as how this all works and some things to consider when creating your manifesto. So what you'll find on the back of your pamphlet is a sticker. The stickers have been evenly distributed as far as what colors you have. And so now you can work amongst each other with everyone that has that color, and there'll be color stickers on the pieces of paper that'll show you what group to go to. You'll go to that place where the stickers are and work amongst each other and think about what should a manifesto include. And once you're finished drafting that, we'll all walk around and vote and consider what statements you have listed. The way that you vote is you put a sticker next to that statement that's written and voting for favor of keeping that into the manifesto. By the end of this, we'll take the most popular statements and then move them into our collective.